Postgraduate Research and Innovation Symposium is one of the premier events in our college's calendar. It gives our postgraduate students a chance to showcase their research to the general public, to their fellow students, to their peers, and generally to a wide audience. We can look forward to a very exciting keynote address from Dr. Debra Roberts, who is the head of Itakwini Municipality's Sustainability and Resilient Cities Initiatives Unit. We can look forward to 200 flash presentations and oral presentations from our master's and doctoral students. We also have 30 online exhibitions from our industry partners, and this all culminates in a very nice prize-giving session where we get to award our best presenters for PRIS 2022, and there's also a lot of lucky prizes up for grabs. This year's event is on climate change, and we're hoping that this year's event will allow our presenters, our master's and doctoral students, to present to a wider audience and show how their research impacts their lives in South Africa, on the African continent, and the rest of the world. Visit our website to register and join us online for PRIS 2022.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 12th College of Agriculture, Engineering and Science Postgraduate Research and Innovation Symposium. This event is one of the highlights in our college's calendar and gives our postgraduate students a chance to present their work to a wider audience, the general public and the university community, showcasing how their work can make an impact to society. An event of this nature exposes our postgraduate students to a conference format, something that they will have to get used to in their professional careers as scientists. Not only do we have to carry out research, but we also have to convince others that our results are actually worth their salt and also sell this research to a varied audience and mostly to our peers in the same discipline as ours. And this platform will enable our students to do just that. In 2022, we have resumed some sort of normality and students have returned to the fields and laboratories. And for the most part, research has continued uninterrupted. This will be the last year we're going to have the online platform. And from 2023, we'll be going back to having the face-to-face format. And I'm really looking forward to that. One thing I enjoy about conferences is interacting with students and staff at the teas and luncheons. And going back to the physical format will allow just that. We really have an exciting 2 days ahead of us. I looked at the program yesterday and the titles and abstracts of the talks are actually enthralling, and we can look forward to some really exciting research topics in all of our 6 sessions. Our theme for this year is climate change, and it has been a buzzword in the scientific and not so scientific community for a number of years now. What is being realized is that if we do not act now, there may be no Earth for tomorrow and for our future generations. In light of this theme, we have chosen a dynamic and exciting plenary speaker, Professor Debra Roberts, who is head of the Ithekwini Municipality's Sustainable and Resilient City Initiatives Unit. She's internationally recognized specifically for her work on climate change, and I'm looking forward to an exciting talk in a couple of minutes. To all our presenters, well done in being chosen to present your work and for having the courage to face a wide audience. It's not easy, but I'm confident that you will do well. And finally, well done to all the supervisors who have prepared their students for this event. We will see the fruits of your labor shortly. So enjoy the next 2 days, and I'm certain it's going to be an interesting, exciting, and enthralling event. We have a special message from Tia with you, with everyone of PRIS 2022.
Greetings to all the postgraduates who are participating in this year's 2022 Research and Innovation Symposium. I would like to acknowledge the presence of Prof. Nandapoku, Prof. Fatuan Mudau, Prof. Neil, and all the other deans who are present in this event. I'm made to understand that this will be a platform where research will be shared. I'm amazed that there will be over 100 oral presentations that will be presented in this event. I'm grateful to be invited here on behalf of TIA and the Innovation Agency, the CEO and the management would have also loved to participate in this event. For us, we as an organization, we are expected to facilitate research knowledge emanating from public-funded institutions, university mostly. So events like this becomes important for us to participate in. I've been made to understand that there will be a diverse group of participants. Over 100 oral presentations will be shared during this symposium. Within our strategy, we'll be looking at how we support the government in implementing the decadal plan of science innovation. Most importantly, also responding to the strategy that we've put forward for the 2020-2025 planning cycle. In that strategy, we plan to do three strategic outcomes. One being implementing the bioeconomy strategy, two, making sure that we expand our intervention in commercialization, and third, mostly to provide science, engineering, technology services to SMME mainly. We have already earmarked a number of STEM, science, technology, and mathematics interventions that we have profiled within our innovation skills development. We are looking forward to bring more of this research that we're going to be seeing and also be discussing to be part of those innovation skills development, such that this concept, this research can have their ideas taken up into the market. We would like to commend the planning from the university. We hope this is another successful event, and we congratulate all the winners and looking forward in strengthening the partnership with university in the areas of science and innovation. Thank you very much for blessing us to participate in this event. We really appreciate it.
Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our plenary speaker for this event, Professor Debra Roberts. Professor Debra Roberts is head of the Ithekwini Municipality Sustainable and Resilient City Initiatives Unit, Durban's first Chief Resilience Officer, and an honorary professor in the University of KwaZulu-Natal Life Sciences. Roberts is co-chair of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Changes Working Group, II, with Professor Hans Otto Portner, and was the first local government practitioner to hold this role. Her work is supported by a WGII technical support unit. Roberts completed her PhD in urban biogeography at the then University of Natal, now UKZN, looking at the interface of science and policy in the design of an open space network to conserve Durban's global significant biodiversity. Roberts is internationally recognized for her contributions to science and society, specifically her eminent scientific work on climate risk management, leadership in the IPCC, and for connecting global change risk to local communities. She has focused on the environmental challenges and opportunities presented by urban areas, exploring solutions to the global problem of climate change as it plays out in local communities in Durban, and bridging the gap between high-level scientific knowledge and people's lived experiences. Under her co-lead and with support from the Bremen and Durban offices of the IPCC WGII TSU, she published the IPCC Special Report and Cryosphere in a Changing Climate in 2019. Contributed to the special report on global warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius and special report on climate change and land. And in 2022, published its seminal sixth assessment report on climate change impacts, adaptation, and vulnerability. Roberts has been named one of the world's 100 most influential people in climate policy and received the African Climate Research Award in 2014. Has sat on various international advisory bodies focused on climate change issues in cities and advised the Global Commission on Adaptation, United Cities and Local Governments, and the United Nations Secretary General's 2019 Climate Summit. She was also a member of the South African United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change negotiating team. Roberts advises the International Presidency of United Cities and local governments on navigating international development processes to optimize the localization of the Sustainable Development Goals and advise the ICLEI, Local Governments for Sustainable Global Executive Committee, on the Durban Adaptation Charter, climate change and resilience issues. She is the recipient of several awards for her biodiversity and climate change work at the local, national, and international level, including an honorary doctorate from the University of Twente in the Netherlands. Roberts has presented several keynote or plenary presentations, and in 2016 was invited to deliver the International Institute for Environment and Development's prestigious Barbara Ward Lecture. A member of the editorial advisory boards of several international urban journals, Robert's own publication focuses on urban issues, including urban open space and biodiversity planning, environmental management, sustainable development, urban climate protection, urban resilience, and climate change adaptation. She emphasizes the concept of informality as a key resilience challenge for African cities. It gives me great pleasure to now welcome Professor Roberts.
Fabulous. Thank you, Neil. It seems you actually know more about me than I know about myself. Some of those were very fond memories. So good morning, everyone, and welcome to anyone who may be dialing in from outside South Africa. It's a fabulous opportunity to be talking to my alma mater and to have this opportunity to share with you some of the key messages that were highlighted in the recent Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, probably better known to yourselves as the IPCC Working Group 2 report, which we released globally in February of this year. And Working Group 2 is the IPCC working group that looks at issues related to impacts, adaptation, and vulnerability. So these are key issues for us in Africa and obviously key areas for African research. Now, I can tell you producing these IPCC reports is no easy task. It really is a monumental exercise. In our case, 5 years, 270 scientists, all volunteering their time, working their way through over 34,000 scientific publications, having to deal with over 62,000 expert and government review comments, each one of which has to be answered individually, to produce ultimately a report, which if you include our supplementary material is just under 4,000 pages long. But gratefully, we don't have time to work through those 4,000 pages today. So what I'll try and do is really pull out some key messages, which I hope will inform your discussions over the next 2 days and cause you to think about how these messages might impact on your research. Probably our biggest headline message is the one you see on the screen. And it's a simple one. You can't argue with the science anymore. The evidence is unequivocal from the scientific research. Climate change is a threat to our well-being. It's a threat to the well-being of the planet that we're so dependent on. And any further delay in concerted global action is going to miss this very brief and rapidly closing window of opportunity we have to secure a livable future for us all, not only current generations, but indeed generations still to come. So let's look at what the report tells us about where we are now, because climate change is a real and present threat now. This is not something that is happening in the future. The report really indicates that global warming has already caused dangerous and widespread disruption in nature. And we've seen this through the increase in the frequency, the intensity and duration of extreme events, not only on land, but also in the ocean. And this is driving mass mortality events. And on the slide in front of you, you can see tree dieback in a drought-stressed forest in California. But importantly too, climate change is affecting the lives of literally billions of people around the world, despite their efforts to adapt. And this is because of the impacts of human-induced intensification of tropical cyclones, of sea level rise and heavy precipitation events. And for those of us who live in Durban, we'll recall those heavy precipitation events of April and May. And certainly attribution studies that have followed indicated that that rainfall event was twice as likely to have occurred because of human-induced climate change. And it's events like those that are driving increased losses and damages around the world. The report also indicates, though, that the impacts of climate change are particularly magnified in the world's cities. And that's of strategic concern to us because the majority of us now live in the world's cities. Some 4.2, 4.5 billion people live in the world's urban areas. And continued exposure to heat waves in those urban areas means an exacerbation of the urban heat island. It means an exacerbation of urban air pollution problems, all of which drive public health concerns. And we know often from personal experience the impact that extreme events can have on urban services. So energy, transport, water and sanitation. And again, for those of us living in Durban, we're all very well aware of the impact that extreme events can have, for example, on water and sanitation services. The report also indicates to us we live in a complex world. We don't live in a world where we're dealing with single extreme events, one at a time. We now live in a world where we're dealing with multiple extreme events occurring together, creating compound risks that are much more difficult for us to manage. So think about a scenario where we experience increasing heat, but also a period of drought. Now, that heat stress will impact on farm workers, it will reduce crop yield, we'll get overall reduced productivity. That means reduced household income for the farm workers, but it also means increased local food prices and potentially an increase in global food prices. And so what this shows is that climate risks simply don't respect national boundaries, and these weather-induced extreme events can indeed shock global trade. And we saw that only this year when India placed a ban on the export of wheat in May of 2022 because of the unseasonably hot weather they were experiencing. And I can recall Zoom calls with the Indian co-chair of the IPCC, and he actually looked like he was melting on the other side of the screen. But that high level of heat affected the wheat crop, and India placed the ban, and that had global ramifications. The war in Ukraine meant that the wheat crops weren't coming out of Ukraine, and India was seen as an important source of replacement. And so we can see how these climatic events can, in fact, impact on the global supply chain. For me, the most important thing about the Working Group 2 report is it's a real reality check. And for me, one of the big messages from this report is don't be myopic. Don't think that the world only revolves around climate change. In fact, climate change combines with a whole basket of other challenges that we have to deal with. So unsustainable use of natural resources, habitat destruction, growing urbanization and inequity. And that combination undermines the adaptive capacity, not only of our own societies, but indeed the natural ecosystems that we're so dependent on. There are also a high number of people who are vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. Our assessment showed us that globally we have somewhere between 3.3 and 3.6 billion people living in hotspots of high vulnerability to climate change. And perhaps unsurprisingly for those of us who live in Africa, the majority of these hotspots occur in Africa, they occur in South Asia, South and Central America, the small island states, and in the polar regions. And again, communities living in these hotspots of vulnerability are not only dealing with climate change, they have having to deal with a whole host of overlapping challenges. So often limited access to basic services, water, sanitation, and health. They often have climate sensitive livelihoods, so smallholder farmers involved in small scale fisheries, and often have to contend, particularly on our continent, with high levels of poverty, weak leadership, lack of funding, and lack of accountability and trust in government. So that's where we are now. Clearly a very challenging future, a real indication that climate change is here and now. But the report also gives us insights into the road ahead. And what does it tell us about that? Well, it indicates and reinforces a really important message that the IPCC has put out into the public debate since our special report on 1.5 degrees of global warming. And that is that every small increase in warming will result in increased risks to nature and people. And here on this slide, for example, you see bleached coral in a dying coral reef off the coast of Okinawa in Japan. And if we look at the impact of an increase in global temperatures on biodiversity, for example, we can see the stark difference in a world at which we limit global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius, and a world in which the average global warming increases to 3 degrees Celsius. But an important point to realize, and this point was emphasized in our assessment, returning to a global warming level of 1.5 after a period of overshoot is not the same as staying at a global warming level of 1.5. So if we look at a scenario where we overshoot a global warming level of 1.5 and then return to that some decades later, you don't reset the system back to where it was. Our assessment shows us that during that period of overshoot, we will still experience irreversible losses. We will see species extinction. We'll see the loss of entire ecosystems, such as those at mountain tops, tropical coral reefs, and coastal wetlands. By the time we reach 3 degrees of global warming, the risk of extinction in biodiversity hotspots increases by about tenfold. And that's of real concern to us if you think about the number of biodiversity hotspots that we have here in South Africa. So why this concern about natural ecosystems? That's often a question I get from policymakers and politicians. It's because we are so reliant on natural ecosystems and the ecosystem services they deliver. So if we put those ecosystems at risk as a result of climate change, we put at risk important services such as pollination of our crops, and that raises the potential for food insecurity. We potentially undermine important economic sectors such as tourism and recreation. And we put at risk access to really basic services such as food, clean air, and clean water. And of course, the communities who are most impacted by that are those who are most dependent on ecosystems. So indigenous communities, ethnic communities, local communities, communities in informal settlements, and so on. The report also gives us a sense of what we might experience in terms of the landscape of future risks. Obviously, with additional warming, we'll see increased exposure to heat waves, and that will affect crops and ecosystems and people around the world. In terms of water scarcity, at a global warming level of 2 degrees Celsius, those regions that rely on snowmelt for their water could experience up to a 20% decline in water availability for agriculture by the middle of the century. We already know that climate change undermines food security. So if we look at a scenario of 2 degrees of global warming by the middle of the century, we're likely then to experience food shortages in sub-Saharan Africa, South Asia, South and Central America, and the small islands, all of which will drive malnutrition. And by the middle of the century, we can expect to have 1 billion people living in low-lying cities by the sea and on the small islands that will be at risk from sea level rise. So that's the picture of where we are and potentially the road ahead. What does the report tell us about how we've been responding to these challenges? It indicates we have been acting, so action on climate change adaptation has increased, but progress is uneven. It's generally small scale, it's fragmented, and we are simply not adapting fast enough. And this, even though we've seen approximately 170 countries around the world and many cities, including Durban, incorporating adaptation into their plans and policies. And so we face a very real adaptation gap. There's this huge gap between what we're doing in terms of adaptation and what we need to be doing. And unfortunately, that adaptation gap is largest for our low-income populations, and this drives inequity. And an important message that emerges from our report is that inequity anywhere in the world undermines the adaptive capacity of us all. But there is some good news that emerges from the report. It indicates that there are still feasible and effective adaptation options available to us to reduce risk to people and nature. But the effectiveness of all of those options decreases as we increase global warming levels. And generally, when we think about adaptation, we think about things like flood risk reduction. We think about securing our water supplies. But our report also talks to us about the value, for example, of improving our health services, because that can allow us to deal with the trauma of extreme events, impact of heat stress, and the spread of disease. And we can further enhance our adaptive capacity by putting in place disease surveillance, making sure that every community has access to an early warning system. And that's been a recent call from the United Nations Secretary General, and doing things like providing basic services such as potable water. The report also calls out that nature offers us significant untapped potential, not only to deal with the impacts of climate change, but to deal with the causes and also the opportunity to support lives and livelihoods. So agroforestry is a climate resilient way of not only producing food crops, but also providing wildlife habitat. And here you can see a Nigerian farmer who's producing rubber trees, but also fruit trees and food crops, and keeping bees as part of a diversified livelihood strategy. The report also offers us a view into what adaptation options exist in key sectors. So in terms of water management, irrigation is a well-known adaptation tool. We've used it for thousands of years. But the report cautions that that could also have a negative impact. We could also see depletion of groundwater supplies. But irrigation, well-planned, well-located, used together with things like rainwater storage, water-saving technologies, and moisture conservation in soils, can have economic and ecological benefits and can reduce the vulnerability not only of our society, but the natural ecosystems that we depend on. There are also wider options, so securing drinking water in our urban areas, working with nature, so for example, restoring wetlands, land use planning, creating no-build zones, And flood and drought risk management are where we are currently focused in terms of the majority of our adaptation responses. But important to bear in mind, all of these water-based adaptation responses, their effectiveness declines with increased warming. In terms of food security, the affected adaptation options called out there include the use of stress-tolerant crops and livestock, agroforestry, farm diversification, community-based adaptation, particularly where we're drawing on local and indigenous knowledge and where that activity is resourced, strengthening biodiversity, helping with pollination and crop pest control. And these sorts of approaches generate wider benefits. They improve food security and nutrition. They improve health and well-being and encourage more diversified livelihoods. For me as a local government practitioner, because that's the second hat I wear, it was really reassuring to see the very large spotlight that our assessment shone on the world cities. They were called out as a global scale, but importantly, a time-limited opportunity to advance climate resilient development. And again, a strategic concern for us because by the middle of the century, up to 2/3 of us could be living in the world cities. Effective options identified here include using nature-based and engineering approaches together. So for example, using gabion mattresses along a river together with floodplain restoration, establishing blue and green spaces in our cities, urban agriculture to improve food security, but also providing social safety nets for disaster management, not only to deal with the impacts of climate change, but also to improve financial security in urban communities. And these generate wider benefits again. So public health improvements, reducing heat stress, providing opportunities for ecosystem conservation. Another important spotlight that emerged from this assessment was a focus on informal settlements. And again, this is really important for us, particularly for Africa, because UN Habitat tells us that by the middle of the century, up to 1/3 of us could be living in informal settlements around the world. Here, effective adaptation options called out, the use of local knowledge together with appropriate skills and funding and tools, and particularly where we see decision makers sitting around the table with local residents, identifying the problem and taking decisions about how we handle them. And of course, government can increase our adaptive capacity through improved accountability, commitment, and transparency. And in these images, for example, you see improved water and sanitation in informal settlements in India. But as I've said before, this report is a real reality check. And one of those is the fact that not every adaptation action is going to deliver the desired outcomes, that adaptation can, in fact, deliver unintended consequences. And we refer to this as maladaptation. So, for example, an adaptation action that increases greenhouse gas emissions or increases inequity. And so you see in these images, on one hand, interventions around coastal defenses and coastal erosion protection that may not indeed protect the people living and working behind them. And that could in fact increase erosion further down the coast compared to a much more nature-based approach to flood risk management being used in Delaware and the USA. Our assessment also pointed out that again, it's those most disadvantaged groups who are most affected by maladaptation. So again, our informal settlers, our indigenous communities, our local communities, our ethnic communities. And again, that important message comes through. Inequity anywhere in the world undermines the adaptive capacity of us all. Another real reality check is there's no silver bullet here. There are real limits to adaptation. Even with our best planning and our best resourcing, our most effective adaptation can no longer prevent all losses and damages. So losses and damages are now baked into the system. And above 1.5 degrees Celsius, some natural solutions may no longer work. So there is no silver bullet because some of the ecosystems we're relying on, they themselves may be impacted by climate change. Above 1.5 degrees, the lack of fresh water could mean that people living on small islands or those who are dependent on glaciers and snowmelt simply may no longer be able to adapt. But the time we reach 2 degrees, it'll be challenging to farm multiple stable crops in many current growing areas, particularly the tropical areas, which are most vulnerable to climate change. No surprise here in terms of the outcome of our assessment, current global financial flows are insufficient, particularly in developing countries. Most of the tracked global finance is going into mitigation, so reducing emissions rather than adaptation. And the climate change impacts I've spoken to you about and the increased losses and damages that we're experiencing obviously reduce economic growth and therefore our ability to invest in improving our adaptive capacity. So we've got a scenario where society and policymakers simply have to begin prioritizing adaptation. But that doesn't mean that we can take our eye off the mitigation ball, because at the same time as that we do more work in the adaptation arena, we have still got to make rapid and deep cuts in greenhouse gas emissions to keep the maximum number of adaptation options open. And this is going to be a tough call. If you look at Working Group 3's report on mitigation, for the last decade they assessed, which was 2010 to 2019, the average annual greenhouse gas emissions were at the highest levels in human history. And I refer you to the recently released Global Carbon Project report, which indicates in 2022, our emissions are still continuing to rise. And therefore, it's not surprising that Working Group 3 reached the conclusion that we are simply not on track to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius. So think about that period, 1990 to 2019. In 2019, our emissions were 54% higher than they were in 1990. And it's over that period that the global society had access to the work of the IPCC, scientific assessments telling us we had a climate change problem and we needed to act immediately to address that problem. The fact that we saw emissions being 54% higher in 2019 than 1990, I think, is indicative of the fact that the trend is not going in the right direction. So how do we accelerate and sustain adaptation in this really challenged world? Well, political commitment is absolutely key. Nothing can be done without it. We have to have follow-through at all levels of government, from international all the way through to local. We need clear institutional frameworks. So we need national governments producing clear climate change policies with clear guidelines and resources that help, for example, provincial and local governments to act. We have to enhance our knowledge of the impacts and risks associated with climate change, because that helps improve action in the policy arena and at the societal level. And there are educational communities, artistic communities can be very helpful in getting that message out. Monitoring and evaluation of the adaptation work we undertake is absolutely vital, because what is good adaptation today may not be good adaptation in 5 years' time or in 20 years' time. Inclusive governance is absolutely critical. We need to see public sector, private sector, and civil society sitting around the table, taking decisions that prioritize equity and justice. And of course, it's always about show me the money, adequate financing. Our report also calls out 5 key system transitions that are absolutely vital to sustaining and accelerating adaptation. These are transitions in our natural systems, in our built environment, in the energy, industrial, and societal sectors. And these are transitions that make the adaptation possible, that will ensure our health and well-being, the health and well-being of the planet and the ecosystems we rely on, that will help us enhance economic and social resilience, but probably most importantly, will help us achieve those low global warming levels that are so vital to ensure that we avoid many limits to adaptation. There are also wider benefits to this more systemic view of adaptation, particularly in helping us achieve the sustainable development goals, because that's ultimately the biggest global project of them all, is ensuring a sustainable development path. If we provide basic infrastructure to rural communities to improve their climate resilience, that helps us with poverty. If we provide green buildings and green spaces in our cities, that contributes to good health and well-being. And policies that increase the access of youth to both land and credit helps us reduce inequality. And if we restore and connect habitats, that helps us protect life, not only in land, but also below water. So what does the report tell us ultimately then about our future? Well, it indicates that there's a spectrum of opportunities that lie ahead of us, a high resilience, low risk future, all the way through to a low resilience, high risk future. And where we end up on that spectrum is really up to us. It depends on the level of ambition we bring to the table as a global society, the extent to which we ambitiously reduce risks through adaptation, the extent to which we ambitiously reduce greenhouse gas emissions, leaving those fossil fuels in the ground to ensure adequate mitigation, the extent to which we invest in critical system transitions like enhanced biodiversity and sustainable cities and settlements, all with this view to achieving sustainable development. And it's this more integrated approach of adaptation, mitigation, and sustainable development together that we refer to as climate resilient development. But for climate resilient development to work as a solutions framework, it's got to be adopted across all spheres of government, across all levels of civil society. We've got to see everyone working together. So we've got to have the public sector, the private sector, civil society sitting around the table, talking about the problems and the way forward. We've got to draw on wide-ranging knowledge. And of course, science is always important. That's what's drawn us all to this particular event today. And that's why the IPCC was established. But we have to remember that science is only one way of understanding the world. There are many other ways of understanding the world. And we have to draw on those different knowledges as well. Indigenous knowledge, local knowledge, practical knowledge. And I can tell you, as someone who wears both a practice and a science hat, very often it's my practical knowledge which is more valuable to me in the real world than my scientific knowledge. Conserving and restoring ecosystems is really vital if we're interested in climate resilient development. And our report calls out that effective and equitable conservation of 30 to 50% of our natural ecosystems can help ensure not only a healthy planet, but healthy human communities. Climate resilient development is dependent on the extent to which we involve marginalized groups, you know, informal settlers, elderly, women, youth, indigenous people. Are they around the table in our research, in our decision-making? It's important that it prioritizes equity and justice in decision-making and investment. And it's also an important platform to reconcile different interests, different values, different worldviews. But ultimately, it's all going to depend on scaled up investment and international cooperation. And I think if we reflect back on the most recent COP that's just occurred in Egypt, there are real questions about whether we're rising to that particular set of challenges. And so ultimately, if we were at school and getting a school card to take home with us, unfortunately, there'd be no smiley faces for the human species. Our past and current development trends have not advanced global climate resilient development. And so this really underscores the urgency that's embedded deep in the DNA of the Working Group 2 report, is that we need urgent action. Starting today, every action and every decision, every individual, every city, every company, every country takes is absolutely vital, because that determines the path either towards climate resilient development or away from it. But again, the report is a reality check. It asks us not to delude ourselves. It indicates that while climate resilient development is desirable and certainly the way to go, it's going to be challenging to achieve even at our current global warming levels of 1.1 degrees Celsius. It's going to become more limited in terms of exceeding 1.5. And if we reach 2, climate resilient development may simply be out of our reach. And so ultimately, I end where I started. You can't argue with the science. Any delay we have as a global society, as a national society, as a local society, in coming together, acting together in an equitable and just way will mean that this window of opportunity will firmly shut in our face. But the report does offer a range of solutions to inform the debate at a variety of levels, and hopefully those solutions will inform some of the discussions you have the next 2 days. So thank you very much for this opportunity to talk to you here this morning. And as I say, really wonderful to be back with my alma mater for a change. Neil, I can't hear you.
Hi, can you hear me now, Debra?
Yes, I can. Thanks.
Perfect. Thank you so much for that very enlightening talk. It's a very topical subject, and I'm sure that it's created a lot of buzz. I can see a lot of questions for you, if you wouldn't mind just answering a few of them. I'm going to start with Chanel from Independent Media, and she says, when we look at Durban and KZN as a whole, there have been natural disasters. The April floods, the destruction has been quite evident. How do we recover from such, and what are some of the solutions going forward in order to attempt to reduce the effects of climate change in these specific areas? How should the city or the province respond to such crises?
Super, thanks Neil, and thanks Chanel for that question. A point I hope I emphasized in my presentation is, if we're looking at climate change, the only effective adaptation tool in the long term is ambitious mitigation. And so there needs to be a strong push to get ahead of the curve and bend that emissions curve. So cities like Durban need to be looking at bold and ambitious mitigation targets. South Africa is already committed to a just energy transition plan, which has been funded by a variety of international governments and others. So mitigation, ambitious mitigation, leaving those fossil fuels in the ground is the surest way to reduce climate change impacts. But we can build resilience into our urban fabrics. And Durban has a long history of this. Neil, you mentioned that my PhD work focused on looking at the conservation of biodiversity in Durban, because we exist and are located in a biodiversity hotspot. Ensuring that we have those natural areas in our cities, that we're protecting our floodplains, that we don't develop in them, is absolutely vital. Protecting those ecosystems that take the peak off floods is absolutely critical. And building resilience by providing basic services. This is a very big message from our report, is you can't separate out development from responding to climate change. People have got to have access to basic services, reliable basic services, to improve their adaptive capacity. So it's as much a developmental narrative as it is a climate change narrative.
Thank you, Debra. Our second question comes from Sash and Manikam. And the question is, do you think that scientists should be stepping into more spaces of activism? It's shocking that in the face of overwhelming evidence and scientifically informed recommendations on the way forward, little care and effort is seemingly being shown as the necessary rate and scale. So should we be picking up our placards and walking through the streets of Durban? Over to you.
And Neil, thanks again for that question. And certainly, I'm sure there are some in the scientific community who would want to do that. But for me, carrying a placard, to City Hall, that's an event that will probably take you 1 or 2 hours. This is a much longer project. Unfortunately, it does simply require hard work. A placard is one thing, but we're only going to get to solutions through hard work. And so I would urge my scientific colleagues, carry the placards if you must and if you will, but build rather bridges to the people in the practitioner community, because that's ultimately where the solution lies. We've got to get science from the scientific research arena into the hands of practitioners, where people like myself can take decisions and allocate resources in different ways. And that takes a lot of hard work. It's much more hard work than painting a placard and marching to City Hall. It requires long-term investment in those relationships. And it also requires the scientific community to humble itself and realize that it's not the only source of knowledge. As I say, the practitioner community is a critical source of knowledge that you need to refine your research questions. If you want to target research that will actually change the world, you need to be talking to people who are actually building and changing that real world. And so I would rather advocate that the scientific community invest in those partnerships, create those boundary opportunities for these different knowledges to speak together. And UKZN has a long and proud history of doing this, of working, for example, with local government, of learning from local government. But we really need to upscale that, because that's where the change comes. The placard, quite frankly, is not going to change much. But you doing research that can help practitioners put money in different places, put infrastructure in different places, conserve ecosystem, improve people's lives, that's actually what's going to make the world a different place.
Thanks, Debra. Our next one is from Kapongo Luma, and he says, great presentation, thanks. It's evident that urbanization is one of the contributors of climate change. Why don't you recommend a way or process that could reverse the migration from urban back to rural areas where more people can be self-sustained?
So that's a really important question at two levels, and thank you for that. And it's important for me to, at this point, because I think we need to all have a knowledge of how the IPCC works. The IPCC does not recommend. Our mantra is that we are policy relevant, but not policy prescriptive in our scientific assessment. So you'll never see the IPCC recommending to anyone. What we lay out is a range of options that governments can choose from. And I think that's an important point to note. But our reports, again, really indicate that you can't think about rural and urban as separate. It's very clear from the scientific research that they're one continuum of urban settlement. It doesn't matter where those people are. We're not going to change anything by moving people back to rural areas, because urban areas, we've shown, through the interlinkages of infrastructure, of financial flows, of movements of services, remittances, and so on. Literally, urban areas only occupy about 1% of the global ice-free land surface. but they literally impact the majority of non-urban residents and ecosystems and ecosystem services because of these connections. So the point is not to move people from urban to rural, because people are naturally going to move into urban areas when they seek opportunities, they want different lifestyles. We can't stop that. But we need to create a more resilient spectrum of human settlement across that full landscapes. And so it's really important our assessment points to the fact that we can't think about urban and rural separate. They're part of the same human settlement continuum, and we've got to be active across that full range.
Thank you. Thank you, Debra. Anonymous question here. What are South Africa's commitments to reduce emissions, and how are these commitments being measured?
Okay, so in terms of emissions, remember that's mitigation. So that's the Working Group 3 report. I also, as an IPCC co-chair, can't speak about individual countries. Again, that goes back to our mantra of policy relevant, not policy prescriptive. But I think it's common knowledge that at Glasgow last year at COP26, South Africa was afforded the opportunity for a just energy transition. Through funding $8.5 billion that have been provided by the UK, US, EU governments and others. And certainly our president was at COP27 launching the plan that envisaged the transition of South Africa's energy sector from the heavy fossil fuel based sector that we've got. And the reason I'm sitting currently in the middle of load shedding and something that's more reliant on renewable energy. So I would refer you to that just economic transition plan that is now public knowledge, and that'll give you a sense of what the country is doing and what its commitments are.
Perfect. Thanks, Debra. Our last question for this morning comes from David Spirit. Don't we need to roll back capitalism to a significant extent for both mitigation and adaptation? Both the extractive industries driving much damage and the individual consumerism that favors private cars over public transport. It's a very important question. Debra, what's your response?
Yeah, and absolutely. And I think the science is pointing to that. You know, the science indicates that the current development path, the current process of economic development and allocating resources around the world is deeply inequitable. We're not getting resources to the areas that need it most, that's curtailing development opportunities, that undermines adaptive capacity. Certainly our overconsumption of the world resources is a critical part of that wicked mix that I spoke about. It's not only climate change, it's overconsumption, it's unsustainable use of resources, it's the challenges of growing inequity. And so we literally have to have a societal revolution. That is what the science is saying. The challenge for us is the science is basically saying all the evidence is pointing to this major change in our development path, in our economies, in the way we value things in the world. But we've literally got a limited number of years to do it. You know, this is the decade of change, the decade of implementation. That doesn't mean the world ends in 2030. The lights will still go on and we will still move forward, but it'll become an increasingly more difficult, divided world wrecked by geopolitical divisions, extreme events. It'll become a much tougher world to live in and it more costly to deal with. And that's the choice we have to make in the next 8 to 7 years is, can we affect the societal revolution that's necessary?
Great. Thank you, Debra. Thank you for that amazing talk. I'm also an alumnus of the University of Natal, so it's great to see our alma mater occupying positions that actually influence government policies and world decisions. So thank you so much for joining us today. And I'm sure everyone appreciated it. We could see from the flood of questions that came in the interest in your talk. And I'm sure the conversation is going to carry on further as we go on into the rest of 2022 and into 2023 and the future. So thank you, Debra, for joining us today.
Great, Neil. A real pleasure to be here and really best wishes for your conversations over the next two days. I need someone who's going to be a successor to all of this work. So I'm hoping that successor is somewhere in PRIS 2022.
Thank you, Debra. Bye-bye. Bye. Ladies and gentlemen, you'll now have the opportunity to win some lucky draw prizes. We've put all the names of the people who registered for this talk and this conference into a box, and we're now going to draw from there. and select some people to win our prizes. I'm just going to draw a name from the hat. So the first prize is a KAS branded picnic bag, which you'll see on the screen next to me. And the winner of that is Napo Masola. So Napo Masola, congratulations. You've just won a KAS branded picnic bag. Our second prize is a pair of headphones, courtesy of ICS, which you'll see on the screen next to me now. And let me draw a winner for that. And the winner of the headphones is Krisha Govinsamy, who's actually an industry exhibitor. So we have a varied audience. So well done, Krisha Govinsamy, you're the winner of that headphones. The last prize is a laptop sponsored by ICS, which you'll see on the screen next to me now. And this laptop is won by the lucky person to win the laptop is Tulisile Mdlaloza, who's one of our students. So well done, Tulisile Mdlaloza. You now have a laptop to help you finish your studies. So this is just a small taste of some of the prizes we have up for grabs. So join us in the closing session for more events, and there'll be more prizes and more lucky draws in the closing session tomorrow afternoon. I wish all the presenters that's going to be presenting today and tomorrow, I wish you well in your presentations, and I hope all the sessions go well. I'll be dropping into the sessions to see how each of them are doing, and I hope you have an exciting and wonderful 2 days. Bye-bye. Yeah.